This is Lansing Online News Radio, LCC Radio, WLNZ 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan. I am Bonnie Bucqueroux, soon to be joined by Bill Castanier, who's hugging himself because it's so cold.
I'm always cold.
And it certainly gets a little chilly down here in the basement. But this is the first award coming up on the Christmas season. Any kind of announcements coming up?
There is. Yeah, speaking of that, there's a good Christmas event coming up that takes you back to the farm. It's Nick von Frankenheisen and his spouse Robin, who are children's book authors and illustrators.
Yeah.
Nick has done maybe 30 books.
Wow.
He's a big time illustrator. But they live in a place in Bath that they open. They have an open house every year, and they sell, of course, their books and his artwork. It's a 40-acre farm, and they let people have the run of the place. They have a lot of interesting farm animals.
Do they sell Christmas trees or something?
No, they don't do that.
Okay.
This is just
a Christmas open house.
An open house. They have food.
Oh.
And it's to see his art. He's a very proficient artist of wildlife.
Oh, wow.
And they do rescue of animals. So a couple of their books are about rescuing animals. It is December 12th through the 13th. And it is, let me give you this. There's two different hours, too. It's 4 to 6:30 p.m. Thursday and Friday, the 12th and 13th. And then Saturday and Sunday, they're open from about noon to 5 o'clock.
Now, is there some place online or somewhere that people can find out?
HazelRidgeFarm.com.
Okay, Hazel Ridge
and
Farm.
And it's just a fun Christmas experience.
Oh, cool.
And if you've never met Nick, he's from the Netherlands. He's been here a long time, but he's a very interesting man.
Hmm. Any authors coming in prior to the holidays?
No, there are not. Nothing now. It's over.
But you have been interviewing and getting ready for a major extravaganza.
Yeah, Wednesday. I recommend everyone read City Pauls because I've spent my life writing the cover story this last week with interviewing Jim Harrison and all his pals for an article about what he's been up to this year. He's got two books out.
Brown Dog is one of them.
It's a collection of his Brown Dog stories, which anyone that's read Harrison, it's about a very primal character, let's say, who enjoys life. And Jim has written 5 novellas previous to this. He's put them all in one book and added a new one.
Wow.
They're very interesting. You either love Brown Dog or you're not real happy about him.
You know, he's certainly one of our Michigan treasures. He no longer lives here. He's down in Arizona now these days, right?
He's in Arizona in the summer, and then he's in Montana
He's
not too smart. He's in Arizona in the winter, and he's in Montana in the summer.
Good move. Doing the reverse, we're going to have to tell Jim.
He is really one of our treasures. He's written probably close to 45 books now.
And I think his book, Farmer, remains one of my favorites. There's just something about, he really does. He captures Michigan so well. So who else were his pals that you got to talk
about? Well, I've Guy Van Deen, who's been a fishing buddy of his since 1970 in Key West. He's an author. He's a French count, very wealthy.
Wow.
Tom McGuane,
mm-hmm.
Another author who graduated from MSU. Greg Orr, who has put together his bibliography. And a guy named Bob DeMott, who has put together a book on conversations with Jim Harrison. And then a couple poets that know him well.
Oh, that's spectacular.
One from East Lansing, Chris Dombrowski. East Lansing High School. And he's a poet now living in Montana.
You've actually gotten to know Harrison fairly well.
Pretty decently.
Yeah.
He'll talk to me.
Yeah.
Which is some people he won't talk to.
Including people who are trying to do profiles of him?
Mm-hmm.
I see. Mm-hmm. That makes life exciting for them.
He's a little picky.
Oh, good. Wow.
Because you cut into his writing time. He writes about 6 to 8 hours a day.
Well, you had an opportunity once to have him and Richard Ford and Thomas McGuane all on the same stage and interview them over there at Cassant Theater.
Right. I tell you, that still is one of the high points of something I've done in life.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. Certainly, there's a lot of stress. Those are the three smartest people maybe that have ever graduated from MSU.
Just keeping up with them.
Except our guest. No, there's... These guys are beyond smart.
They are.
And that's what makes them great writers.
And you were able to really facilitate a dialogue among the three of them. And I've always found it so amusing that they all came out of Michigan State, whereas in the state, everybody would have assumed that any literary lions would have come out of U of M. But
right.
Instead, we got them.
Yep. They're here.
Yeah.
And they're much more successful than really any authors that have come out of the University of Michigan.
Quite quite spectacular. Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to that
one. They're still all writing like crazy. They haven't slowed down.
I've been watching, I've lost my DVD of Harrison and Gary Snyder sort of walking around.
Oh, Etiquette of Freedom.
Yes, it's a wonderful DVD that sort of, just what you see are two men in their later years reflecting back on what life means and what the literary life means. And it was really quite a charming DVD, I thought.
It was. And Gary Snyder, for those who don't know, is probably pretty close to the last remaining beat poet.
Yeah. They didn't live very long.
No, but he lives a Zen-like existence, so he lives much longer than the others.
Even if
he didn't do what they did.
Well, there's that. Yeah. Yes, yeah. That was, unfortunately, the beat poets were a short-lived phenomenon.
They had a fuse going that was burning a little too fast.
Well, changing gears into our first guest, we are greeted today by Eric Schertzing, comes for once a month and tells us what's going on in the community. He is both the Ingham County Treasurer and he is also with the Ingham County Land Bank. And he lets us know whether the community is headed up, headed down, all sorts of things. You've got an open house coming up this week that people will want to go to, is that right?
We do, and everybody is welcome. The Land Bank Authority every year does a nice holiday bash with food and drink. We do it around something that we've done of note to celebrate. This year is in the old Art Alley space on South Washington, Wednesday the 11th from 4 to 6 p.m. And we're going to have hard hat tours across the street to the old Ramones that Alan Hooper has purchased for renovation. And they're in the middle of starting to do some serious work on that property, kind of waiting for the streetscape and the Board of Water and Light plant to get up and running to make things economically more viable down there.
Ooh. Is that going to be a restaurant then?
I have not heard a full service restaurant. I've heard about a coffee shop and there's some office space in the old DNC store area there to the north part of the building.
Well, that area is certainly just driving down it. It's really cleaned up.
Absolutely,
it's unbelievable what you can do.
Yeah, and we're working with CB Richard Ellis and the folks at LEAP to do an RFQ, RFP process also after the first of the year on the old Deluxe Inn site. Because that's a real signature property in that area, being on the 496.
And the river.
And the river and Washington. And so it's great visibility. Yeah. So we'd really like to attract somebody national, that would do a significant size development. It's a little bit of a quiet area there between the budding, romance of Rio Town and downtown, but if something, something cool can happen there, I think it'll really meld everything together and make that area pop.
I loved it when the graffiti was there. That was at the Deluxe Inn. Before the teardown of the building, you had all these local artists, and some artists from out of town come in and load the thing down with graffiti. That was a great experiment, I thought.
Yeah, great expression of art.
Yeah.
And had some great stories that came out of that. There's panels of that. We saved and did a fundraiser for Reach Art Studios and the Rio Town Commercial Association. And I still run across places where they have those panels hanging up as wall decorations and stuff.
So. You should have started a rumor that Banksy was...
Banksy.
Banksy.
Yeah.
Was in town.
Yeah.
$600,000 or so, it wouldn't have been bad to have one of those.
Banksy spent his month in New York, remember?
30, yeah.
And what I loved was that at one point he had a local street person selling his artworks, and he was selling them for $30 a piece. And it was, they figured that the total that he had for sale there was somewhere around $1.5 million of Banksy's art. And he was giving, and one woman was shrewd enough to have argued and worked and negotiated with the person. She got like six of them for $30. So.
Wow.
To be in Central Park that day would have been nice.
Oh, yeah, that was wonderful. Yeah. I've been interested in that, Eric, because that's the size development that I really appreciate. It's the kind of thing where it's done, it's sort of small bore businesses, a lot of it, done by locals, not chains, not, the kind of developments that we see in Old Town and Rio Town. It's a sort of human scale development compared to some of the other things that we see. Is that a model for the future? How much of that can a community support?
Well, the challenge is really on the lending side.
Is it?
There's only so many different types of development that the lenders are really used to. So it depends on how much you can kind of home grow your own capital. That's why the older buildings you know, were a nice thing. They got a hold of things in Old Town on the cheap.
Yes, they did.
And they were able to do things. You had some folks like Terry Terry that really,
yeah,
really grew the area. But it's tough to really do that in an organic fashion if you need a lot of money to be able to pull it off.
So it's access to capital that's the big issue.
Yeah. I mean, but a lot of those, that's why they're not that huge of projects, because they just can't get it off, and it's self-financed.
Hmm. When I see the kind of money, for example, that bankrupt city is willing, like Detroit is willing to put into the new stadium, that, you know, people are always urging them to have tax dollars for, it always strikes me as so strange that we, I mean, that's the amount, for those amounts of money, we could do a heck of a lot of little type of Rio Town and Old Town scale development for the same, you know, for a fraction of that money. So it's just being able to work with banks and other lenders to be able to make that available.
Yeah, and of course, you know, the Detroit project, that's the family has a track record. That's really something that everybody got on board. And, you know, folks can only focus on so many things. So if you want them to focus on little developments, you only get them to focus on a couple. If you can get a big one, you can get them to focus on a big one. So the Deluxe Insight, for example, you know, that's likely to be somebody out of area or even out of state coming in to do a significant, you know, multi $10, $20 million project, we would hope. Get some height, but that doesn't mean that there couldn't be spaces for local artists and restaurants and, you know, some residential along the river and stuff. But the fundamental, you know, project really takes a lot more than local capital usually.
Have you been eyeing the apartment building that's just south of that on the east side?
Well, you know,
what's that one called? I love that building.
I kept track of it because I think Bank of America took it back on a mortgage foreclosure a couple of years ago, and I know Scott Gillespie was in some conversations with the bank. Somebody else came along and bought it. You know, it probably needs a lot of work. I don't think they, I think they paid under $1 million for the building, if I remember. So probably they have pretty good cash flow now without a lot of improvements. But, you know, if we can get some good things going in the area, that'll put them under pressure to improve the game. As is true of Pat Gillespie's developments, both at Marketplace and also the one he's got going right between Lansing and East Lansing there where the dollar, Silver Dollar used to sit. You know, that new construction, like Stadium District did, is going to raise the quality of what people expect in the community. And East Lansing has certainly done some of that in a couple of downtown
What's going on
projects.
Next to City Market? They seem to be at work at it still.
Well, that's Pat's.
That's Pat,
so
Pat
what
Gillespie's.
That, what will that be?
So Marketplace.
That's Marketplace.
You know, 100-plus residential and some, I think there's maybe some
so
commercial
options. So
it's a
mall-type place again? Is it
yeah.
going to be built along the model again where there are stores on the base and apartments above?
You know, I'm not sure how much retail there is in that lower level. You can see that challenge if you look around, well, anywhere. I mean, I've been in California and Florida over the last
mm-hmm.
few years. You know, everybody wants, you know, Nathan and I, we want people to have commercial in that first floor, but all too often it sits empty.
Mm-hmm. Ah, okay.
You know, I think Pat's very close on the ballpark area in having that last space leased.
And that's been how
but
many
that's,
years?
That's been, you know, six,
yeah.
7 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's how tough it is to fill some of that space. And then the businesses, they want parking in front. Well, that isn't how our walkable, you know, lovable areas
right.
were built historically. So you're really fighting against some history.
The retail underneath the facility on the corner of Hagedorn and Mount Hope seems to have filled relatively quickly. It didn't seem to take as long to get commercial in that area. Is that because in East Lansing, we'll enjoy having Nathan Triplett join the conversation. Is it easier to do that model maybe in an East Lansing community, do you think?
Well, the project that you're talking about, the Hamptons of Meridian down there, is actually in Meridian Township, not East Lansing. It's very close, though. But I think that Eric's right. Part of that, it's a challenge to fill those spaces. But another piece of it, which is why the Hamptons of Meridian is somewhat remarkable, is location counts when it comes to filling those spaces. Marketplace is a good example. It's just far enough off what you'd consider to be the normal walkable radius from a high density of housing, where I think it makes it difficult to put in retail options there, which is when we start looking for commercial alternatives or other type of non-residential uses to fill it. But it's a very delicate balance where you see these mixed-use projects really succeeding are high density areas that have a large residential component where you have enough people who are walking and maintaining some kind of street vitality to support them. In mid-sized cities like East Lansing, for example, that can be a difficult threshold to pass. It's a little easier in downtown Lansing, especially with some of the recent development, but there's a sweet spot you have to find.
There is that new concept, well, I don't know how new the concept is, but it is that concept of work, live, play, or I'm not sure the order that you want to put them in. I think usually the corporation wants you to work first, live second, but is that a viable, or are we the size of community that that makes sense for overall in our new developments where you could live in one spot, not have to go too far and have everything at your fingertips?
I don't want to get ahead of you, but I think you're going to talk about the corridor and the you know, potential bus rapid transit and stuff. And if you can combine it with other placemaking tools like that, I mean, I took the bus here tonight. I didn't need to get the van out. You know, that happened to work. But that bus route one is where you can make it happen, you know,
right,
from East Lansing to downtown. So that's why you see Stadium District that went up. That's why you see the Midtown where the Dollar site sat. And Marketplace is not very far off. It's less than two blocks off of that main bus route. So I think the opportunity exists, you know, in a half mile corridor to Michigan Avenue to do a whole bunch of things.
This is LCC Radio, WLNZ 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan.
Well, one of the things that's going to be, I assume both of you know about this, will probably go, is Collegeville Revisited, which is going to be out at the road this Wednesday at 6:30. It's kind of a visioning plan that the road is involved with. Tell us about it, Nate.
Yeah, I actually can't say enough about this project. If anyone who's followed planning in this region, especially in East Lansing, knows we've been doing our comprehensive plan rewrite and working on the Park District charrettes and going through this corridor planning process that the Tri-County Office on Aging is directing. And the reason I raise those things is all of them are very reality-based. We're sort of confined by our zoning codes and our comprehensive plan and all these things that keep us from really looking outside the box. This project that the Broad is running, this year-long exhibit, Collegeville Reimagined, is bringing in architects, artists, other people in the planning field once a month over the course of the next year to really look outside the box and think about what could you do in East Lansing, what would be desirable. So they had their kickoff last month. It was a pretty amazing event, and this is the next piece of that series here on Wednesday evening at the Broad Museum. I'd highly encourage people to attend. And don't go with preconceived notions. Go thinking that this is an opportunity to really engage in a dialogue with folks about our imagination for the future. It's less down to brass tacks and more aspirational. What could we be in 2030 if money were no object and we had the ability to do things that were outside the mold? It's a really interesting thing.
And I don't know if they'll repeat it or not, but they had wonderful food at the first one.
And pretty good art.
That's right.
And wonderful art. You know, so it's all those things you would want at 6:30 at night.
So you can't miss.
You can't miss.
A learning opportunity and a great evening out.
Speaking of food, everybody's touched a nerve with discussions about whether the Goodrich Super ShopRite is going to survive next to campus or not. Is there any word on that? Where do the negotiations stand with?
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting situation. Because Goodrich is such a loved component of the community, there's a lot of emotion around it. I think one of the things that's important to recognize at the outset is that this is a very well-publicized private negotion between
a landlord
and his tenant that the city, unfortunately, has very little, nothing to do with. And it's gotten mixed up in this proposal to redevelop the plaza. So on the one hand, you have a plaza in many ways that hasn't been well maintained. It's not its highest and best use. There's other things there, especially with the redevelopment of the train station coming and that gateway really being more highly utilized by MSU. There's clearly a need for redevelopment. And in many ways, what's happened with the Goodrich lease negotiation on the side has prevented us from having that conversation around the rest of the redevelopment plan, which is sort of a non-answer to your question. But all those things are still in flux right now. And the proposal itself, the development, the piece the city actually has a role in, has actually slowed down to the point where it's not going to be back in front of the Planning Commission until after the first of the year, and then it'll move forward from that.
It is a sort of tired area when you look at, you know, the old Pretzel Bell is gone and some of those buildings. One of the challenges, I think, for people is that it's so difficult to get into and out of that whole area. So there is some need to maybe rethink how people can access it, you know, I always feel like I'm taking my life in my hands when I try to make a left back to get to campus from there.
You know, I think there's a lot of hope on the part of folks for the in and out to get better. It's a tough area to work with, though.
It is, isn't it?
And you know, the two neighborhood groups really are kind of comfortable with keeping things pretty much the way they are. So there's some major challenges there that I'm sure the city's going to grapple with. So it's good to have this conversation. It's good to have the focus on it. Whether it will improve those issues or not, I don't know.
You know, also I think with Whole Foods coming at the edge of your
city,
that's going to be a big deal changer for a lot of businesses in East Lansing and Okemos and Meridian Township.
One of the things that kind of worries me is that as a photographer, right, I like to take pictures and I read a lot about food. Now, if you think I can take the camera into Meijer or Kroger or any one of those stores or Whole Foods and start snapping photos in your dreams, I mean, they are on your, like, as they say, the proverbial white on rice, which is a nice food metaphor there. The minute you walk in with a camera, they don't want you doing that. I went into Goodrich's once prior to a holiday and asked if it, well, yeah, sure, go ahead, and here we'll show you. I mean, they're just, it's such a friendly atmosphere compared to sort of the antithesis of corporate food, industrial food, that, you know, I really appreciate places like that that have that sort of local touch. And it's going to be very hard with something like Whole Foods coming in. I think it threatens the food co-op. It threatens Foods for Living. It threatens all kinds of places, including Goodrich's. Is that a done deal?
Well, I think that in all likelihood, again, the Whole Foods is on the boundary of East Lansing. It's actually just in Meridian Township, although it's been branded as the East Lansing Whole Foods.
Right.
But I think that your first comment is right. I mean, that's a game changer in terms of the grocery market here, which has been relatively stationary for many years, and it's not well laid out. And I think this is a real challenge to that, because this new facility will be so much closer to many of the neighborhoods so that it could be accessed on the number one bus line. And you can do it more easily than you could get to either the Okemos Meijers or the East Lansing Meijers or the Frandor Kroger, and certainly more than Goodrich's down on in the south side of the city. So I think it's going to be, it's hard to anticipate what the impact of it will be, but there certainly will be an impact.
Yeah, those three existing stores aren't all going to survive.
No, they're not. No. And it's going to be hard to figure out. I'm not sure I'd know which ones to put my money on, to tell you the truth. I mean, because
Whole Foods.
Which one's going to die?
Yeah.
Which of the three, or how many, could be two of the three that don't survive. It's going
to
be a tough
one. Let's get back to Michigan Avenue. What do you two see going down from where Frandor is west? And what's your vision for 2030?
Well, there's a don't all speak at the same time.
Well, let me talk about the one piece that people say they're grappling with, but I'm not sure I feel it. You know, so the Midtown development where the Silver Dollar used to sit is really a very fascinating building as a test case for what the potential is. The floodplain issue is where I'm going on this.
Yeah.
You know, that has the apartments have parking underneath. We were able to help some of the cost and the financial structure for that through our brownfield plan. The PNC Bank branch, I go there every week or so and walk around the site and try to keep a handle on it. So the PNC branch is built like a bathtub to hold water out, because you've got 6 feet of floodplain depth in a 100-year flood event in that area. So then you have to weigh the bathtub down, and they poured 36 inches of footings, of cement-reinforced footings, to hold the bathtub down, so if it ever gets surrounded by water, it doesn't pop up. Well, that adds 20-30% or so to some of the cost of doing things. And the south side of Michigan Avenue gets deeper into the floodplain. So, you know, it's pretty hard to do big box unless you elevate the whole kit and caboodle above parking. And it's just going to cost more. And the financial structure of Lansing, even of East Lansing, has, you know, has the challenges, but the financial structure of the property values to support that extra 30%,
we have to wonder.
I'm just not sure how much it's there or what it's going to be there for. So that's going to be a challenge in that little, you know, strip. You get further down towards the city of Lansing and the capital, and you rise up out of the floodplain, and your options open up. But challenges.
And that's based on the 100-year floodplain from the past, which does not necessarily comport with what's happening with the extreme weather we're starting to see. So you could start seeing that become the once every 10 or 20 year flood.
Well, look what happened in Grand Rapids downtown this last year.
Yeah.
No one ever expected there'd be an inch from the carousel.
Right.
I mean, I was just shocked when I saw it. I just never thought the water would come up that far again.
So are we going to have to overbuild on all of our buildings now to be able to deal with these possibilities of extreme weather coming up?
I think you do see an increasing realization on the part of urban planners who work with municipalities and counties and other units of government that resilience is important for the future, that whether it's extreme weather events driven by climate change or any of the other things that are attendant with those changes, communities have to be in a position to engage in activities that will allow them to be sustained into the future. So, you know, the buzzword about some of these things used to be sustainability with a more environmental focus. It's transitioned into the idea of resilience.
Resilience,
where we're really,
yeah.
If you look at what happened with the hurricanes in Louisiana or Hurricane Sandy,
yeah.
It's no joking matter.
Mm-hmm.
That it's a real cost to local units of government to be able to continue to provide service and to sustain themselves in the face of these events. Now, do we have to worry about a hurricane here in Michigan? No. But do we need to worry about flooding of the Red Cedar and the Grand River? Yes. Do we need to worry about increased snow events? Yes. There are any number of other things, too, that are part of that mix.
Wind
that are
events,
part of our process. Yeah.
What we're seeing, Bill McKibben has written, one of his latest books, EAARTH, because he said Earth has already changed. He said the big challenge for the future is going to be insuring these projects. We're now seeing government having to insure floods, for example. The insurance market went out of that years ago. And it could get to the point where government is less and less likely to want to encourage rebuilding afterwards. So this may be, you know, this is that tipping point time where we don't know yet exactly what climate change is going to wreak on our communities. But we have to start thinking about things like sustained rains where, you know, 6-8 inches falls in one day, that kind of thing, and totally overwhelmed systems. So
now, you know, I mean, the opportunity which folks would have to adjust themselves is how do you make things more affordable? Is you put more height into the projects.
Right, you go up instead of
yeah.
sprawl.
And but that's, you know, that's hard. That doesn't fit our Midwestern sensibilities. So people really have to evolve into that. You know, East Lansing has had a heck of a time with some of the community members over, you know, going into height for, you know, for students or whatever. And I'm one of those folks that believes you get height however you can get height, because you're not a big city. You're not a real area.
Including sneaking
you have
an
that.
Extra floor in now and then?
Well, you know, I mean. Those,
some people go for height even
though. That's a whole nother show.
Yeah, I think. But I'd like to ask Nathan, I know this is like the bad puppy, but the East Lansing State Bank, that whole,
mm-hmm.
where do we stand on it? Maybe in a couple of years we'll see something different there?
I think it'll be sooner than that. DTN, which was the developer that the city selected through our RFP mm-hmm. process, has done 3 public planning charrettes. They're actually presenting to the city council along with the planning staff the results of some of those charrettes and the process forward at tomorrow night's city council work session. I attended 2 of those 3 charrettes and was very impressed by the product that they had put together, but there's a lot of questions that still need to be answered. And I think part of the reason that there's been so much back and forth on this particular project is everyone recognizes that corner of Abbott and Grand River is really a keystone property for the whole downtown. It's the western entryway. There's so much anticipation because of the length of time this process has taken that people want to get it right, which sort of goes to a broader point that Eric raised, at least by inference, with this floodplain issue, which is that when Bonnie asks the question, is there a place for the live, work, play concept in our community? Theoretically, that whole corridor is a great opportunity for that transit-oriented, high-density, mixed use. But that theoretical reality, where it meets the road, so to speak, is with the financial component and being able to put something together that the private sector is going to be able to build. Since, well, with this project in particular, since there are public parcels and the city's involved through TIF incentives, we have a role to play, but that's not going to be true for every project along the entire corridor. It can't be. We can't afford it.
I think 2 years ago I counted 45 vacant lots along the corridor, something like that, where you could put townhouses or whatever. I mean, but they're just single vacant lots or 2 lots, something like that. But I was surprised just from East Lansing to downtown how many spots were available for housing.
The dramatic change that I've seen being on campus are the way that students have been moved off into these places like the lodges and the places that are more remote now. I mean, I see those huge buses come in and bring the deposit the students. I have to wait for them to come to some of my larger classes on occasion. But when I'm looking at that kind of development, one of the things that I remember is that the goal was to not have the critical mass of students in a place like a Cedar Village where we would get the periodic riots. And when we're talking about that Collegeville thing coming up, you know, at the Broad, I keep thinking, is the logo going to be a burning couch? Because that seems to be the thing that makes everybody just go crazy. Frankly, I don't care that much about a burning couch. That seems to me a fairly safe thing to torch in the middle of the street. Do we need some sort of place where kids can go on campus? They used to go to Munn Field, but then they closed that off. Do we need to think about giving kids a place to go and have a bonfire and have some activities so that it's an escape valve?
It's certainly been something that's been discussed, but I think also some context for this is important. If you remember in 2008 when there was the Cedar Fest revival that the
yep.
police department had to disperse because there was property destruction and violence involved, there was a much bigger to-do about it. What no one remembers is that there were comparable sized crowds that gathered then in 2009 on the anniversary of that event, but because there was no violence and there was no property destruction, the police monitored the event from the outside and let people celebrate. The problem with these events is not the large size of the crowd, it's that people get involved in dangerous activity. You know, early Sunday morning, what transpired in Cedar Village that was of great concern, I think, to most people was, in particular, the three large fires that at times reached 15 or 20 feet in height in the middle of a public street with 2,000 people surrounding it. That's a recipe for injury. We're very lucky that no one was injured in that process. So I think that we have to figure out ways to deal with that problem behavior while acknowledging the fact that when something really fantastic for our community and the university happens, like winning the Big Ten championship, like going to the Rose Bowl for the first time in a quarter century, people are going to want to celebrate.
Yeah.
But I don't think we should ever accept the premise that celebration involves property destruction or violence against police or setting things on fire and endangering people. And I would just add one caveat because I've heard that similar comments about how bad is a couch fire really. There were 56 fires roughly around East Lansing on this night, and perhaps none of them except for the larger ones in Cedar Village in and of themselves posed any danger to the surrounding structures or whatnot. But what they did is it kept the fire department busy all night, going from couch to couch to put them out, so they couldn't respond to a real incident had it occurred.
I see.
And so it's a real draw on public safety, and that endangers everyone else.
And it's bad for the karma of the city from the standpoint of people in France see it.
Well,
got publicity worldwide.
Well, and I think the problem is here we sit having this conversation as though it's a city or a university phenomenon, when the reality is even if you were talking about just the student component, there are about 2,000 people in Cedar Village. There are 49,300 students at Michigan State, plus the whole rest of the community. This is a very small fraction of individuals who are using what should be an opportunity for celebration as an excuse to engage in destructive behavior. And I think that Bill's right. At times, we allow this to become something that defines us when what it should be is an opportunity to define ourselves in opposition to it. It's not MSU, it's not East Lansing, and it's not acceptable. And I think more and more you see people making that message clear, but it's going to take time to do that. And there's some things that are beyond our control, and we can just have to do the best we can in responding to these incidents when they occur.
This is LCC Radio, WLNZ 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan. We're talking with East Lansing Mayor Nathan Triplett and with Ingham County Treasurer Eric Schertzing. And I think part of the challenge, if we look at the history of it, is that they had difficulties one year when they tried to close off Munn Field. You know, part of it is where do you hold these? How do you hold them? How do you make them safe? I still think, though, there's something primal about fire and those nice bonfires that people like, I mean, pep rallies. We don't have enough pep rallies. I think we need more of that, more escape valves that maybe we could take some of the pressure off if we had more opportunities for students to blow off a little steam. But it certainly seemed to me that when you're looking at finals week coming up with all that pressure and the fact that there hasn't been a win like this in 25 years, it was almost predictable that we should have had some sort of plan in place to make sure students had a way to blow off steam.
Yeah, and I think, you know, in the wake of the situation that occurred in 2005 after then Mayor Meadows and the City Council convened a review committee, which Eric's
mm-hmm.
wife actually sat on at the time, made some excellent recommendations, which is one of the reasons why events like what happened this weekend are handled much better than they were even back in 2005. have all those recommendations been completely implemented? Have we answered every question? Not yet. And one of the questions that does still remain is there a way to provide a celebratory alternative that people
yeah.
will participate in? Folks forget that has been tried from time to time over the course of MSU's history and East Lansing's history. But what we find normally is that if authority figures are planning a celebratory event, people don't want to participate because it doesn't have the allure of that organic, natural, student-centered celebration. It looks like the man planning a party for you, which no one
yeah.
wants to show up for.
Yeah. Yeah, this is, you know, these are the Burning Man started out on the West Coast as a sort of spontaneous, let's build a, you know, build a place and then torch this guy at the end. And that was that same sort of impulse where young people have this desire to want to create their own communities, not have someone, you know, if it had been laid out by the city planners, I don't think they would have showed up to do Burning Man at that same facility.
Well, you know, I mean, you're right, Bonnie. I mean, I'm a farm boy, and you know, we Friday night drinking, I had bonfires. I mean, that's
they still do that.
I'm sure they still do.
Maybe we could start cow tipping. Wasn't that part of your heritage? Did you have a cow tip? No, tip a cow. I've never seen that done.
I did not. I mean, I grew up on a farm, so I think that's animal cruelty. You know, so
I have no idea. I don't even know what they do to tip a cow.
You just run into them hard enough.
Push them over.
People and they.
Oh, that's mean.
Yeah,
oh,
they're standing there asleep, so
yeah.
they just go right on over. So.
Oh, well, I guess I've never seen that.
But you know, I think probably you know we could be more creative and be more experimental.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, obviously, what we've done hasn't perfected this process, but to give them ways to release it can't be driven by authority, but it is a, you know, it is an agricultural history university. There are farm fields, there are areas where you could do
I'm
stuff
surprised
but
how hard
they go
there because it was cold. I mean, usually the worry is that, well, it's going to be warm weather and that's what's going to cause the problem. In this case, they proved that, boy, it could be really bitter cold out there. You could still.
Looking at my thermometer on my phone at City Hall at about 3:30 in the morning while this was happening, it said that it was 10 degrees outside.
Oh,
wow. Bitter cold.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, it's alcohol. I mean, it's alcohol abuse. You know? People
we
do
have
stupid
a challenge.
Things.
We have a challenge. It is, yes. Maybe. We see now when they put in those new new recreational marijuana laws, all we'll have to have is a lot of snacks and maybe
there might be something to that.
They'll roast marshmallows.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
You know, I do think though on a more positive note, frankly, I made the comment about defining ourselves in opposition to it. I spent part of my afternoon in a meeting with President Simon and senior MSU administration with the city manager and our police chief, and out of that report from 2005. A much stronger cooperative relationship has been built that's helped address these events. And I think Eric's right. We're not quite there yet. There's more work to be done. But what we have now that we didn't have then is the foundation to build upon to find those creative solutions and really try and tackle the problem where before we just didn't know what we were doing. We've grown a lot in that time. And I think you see the outcome in the fact that there were no injuries this weekend, that we didn't have police officers injured. And that by and large, it was a small fraction of people participating.
And you really didn't end up needing to call in outside police much, did you?
There was some assistance from Ingham County and Lansing and the state police. But what's different, I think, is we were able to send in individual squads of 8 officers over time who would go in, pick out troublemakers, bring them out. And at some point, it became just the presence of the officers on the street would allow people to disperse without any further direct engagement. That's again a tactical change that was born out of 2005. Rather than showing up with massive presence
and
basically inviting a fight,
yeah,
we use a more targeted, softer touch approach and we get better results. Fewer injuries, faster dispersal, less property damage, and the community benefits from it. Our police department has really become a leader in that.
I think they've been a lot smarter in the way they've handled that because before it was like, I know I happened to have been downtown at one of the courts prior to one of the early, you know, decade ago when there was a lot of concern about clashes. And I heard some police officers talking in the hallway about how they could hardly wait to try out some of their tactics and, you know, in essence, cause trouble. They couldn't wait to get their hands on a few of the students at the upcoming game that Saturday. And I thought, ooh, this is not a good situation. That's not the attitude you want. You want that kind of tactical approach where small groups of officers go in and deal with, you know, the individual troublemakers and not just a huge sure force. I just didn't think that it got, I didn't realize there were 55 fires. I didn't realize it got that far out of control. But we'll see what, I mean, compared to some of the ones in the past, it wasn't bad.
it was more tame than ones in the past, and I think folks need to remember this fire association with athletic events is something that's being seen at campuses and in communities all across the country now that universities are struggling with. So
and pro teams too,
right? And even some pro athletic events now, and outside the United States, frankly, there you can recall there was that huge fire incident in Vancouver last year around the professional sporting event. So this is something lots of communities are struggling with, and we're all trying to find the best solutions to keep people safe.
Did you have a police presence in those areas prior to the game?
Yeah, there's when these events are coming, there's always a police presence prior to. But again, we try and keep it as a soft touch where people are monitoring mm-hmm. the situation so as not to egg people on. You know, I've been witnessed in person now three of these events from some capacity of the city before as a Human Relations Commission member on the council twice now. And what you see is people who see the police and see that as an invitation to try and chant. It's a remarkable thing to see people chanting for tear gas, because it's become this sort of perverse thing that they want the experience of it. And our officers are very good about not giving into that and saying no and using
that
soft
touch.
They
chant that until they've had a taste of it, I suspect.
Well, and the other thing to remember too is these students cycle out every about 4 years as undergrads. So every time we get 10,000 new freshmen in every year, they have to be re-socialized about this situation. So it's always going to be a constant challenge for us. We're never going to find a silver bullet that's going to fix it all, because we'll always have new students to have to address.
I don't know that this is part of, I mean, we have so many international students now too. I suspect many of them had to be baffled by what was going on, because it's probably not part of their culture.
There's an article in the Lansing State Journal over the weekend, 7,300 or something like that.
Over 7,000 international students.
3,700 from China.
Yeah, right. It's amazing. I see so many of them in my classes.
I was out on campus a couple weeks ago in Berkeley, and that was the first thing I noticed.
Oh, yeah.
The number of different languages I was hearing.
Yeah.
And I was just walking around.
Yeah.
It's remarkable, the difference in a very, very short time period.
I'm going to be working on a project next semester looking at Red Cedar Elementary in East Lansing, and they say that there are students from 50 different countries there. It's an amazing school. We do have a very rich culture there on campus now, a very international flavor. Well, I want to thank Eric Schertzing and Nathan Triplett for joining us this evening. It's been wonderful. Thank you very much. We're going to see all sorts of interesting changes over the next decade in both Lansing and East Lansing, I suspect. Thank you very much. We're going to shift gears now. This is LCC Radio, WLNZ 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan. And I'm going to welcome Mary Sharp to the table. And it's good to see you, Mary. I am the reason that we're going to be talking about this issue, we're going to be talking a little bit about dealing with the holidays and dealing with family members who have different kinds of needs. And tonight we wanted to talk about autism. I have a very good friend who Facebooked the other day, and I thought it was really a poignant post that she made. She lives in Wisconsin, and she has a daughter who is somewhere on the autism spectrum. And she was saying, please be kind at Thanksgiving dinner when relatives come and they bring a child or a young person who either wants to carry a book or who doesn't want to be necessarily part of all of the hugging and family warmth that necessarily goes on at a Thanksgiving dinner. Try to understand that in this era there are kids with varying needs, and that kids on the autism spectrum, making them comfortable is part of really that family tradition. And I'm hoping, Mary, tell us a little bit about your organization, what we need to know.
Well, what a wonderful invitation, and thank you for bumping up our idea of community to include the whole spectrum of human experience. You know, with the conversation you were having before, one of the things that I was very well behaved and didn't come running in and say, and part of the variation that we need to include in our housing needs is the different family constellations that can occur uh-huh. with developmentally disabled people.
Yeah.
And that housing needs to consider what are we doing, not just in universal design, but in the kinds of social constellations that people have varying needs, rather than the traditional single person, which is the increasing household.
Yeah.
And then the traditional sort of what family, you know, distribution of, you know, a couple adults and a bunch of little people.
All those little things I see on the backs of cars where they have a little outline.
Right, and the dog.
Took me a while to figure out what those were. I wasn't quite sure what they're trying to tell me.
I almost have compassion fatigue about autism, which is interesting because my son is 24 years old and I've lived with autism, you know, for that long. And so most of the time I like to talk about the kinds of work that we do at the Mid-Michigan Autism Association as being work that that fights for change that is compatible for all people with intellectual or developmental disability, mm-hmm. rather than singling out autism. But the needs, lots of people in education think that if you can educate to autism, you include a whole bunch of other disabilities along the way with that. Traditional special education teachers are sort of taught about intellectual disability, and they, I don't know how much detail they have about physical disability, but the thing with autism is that there are so many very, very difficult behaviors associated with that. Sometimes the behaviors are what become the elephant in the room where everyone talks. And you know, the disability community has people so frightened about being politically correct or jumping down their throat that people are afraid to ask questions because they don't know what the right term is. And I think we've done ourselves a little bit of a disservice. But so when I'm talking about autism, I'm talking about our group of kids that have problems with social communication. Mm-hmm. And then the other part of the definition is intense interests in restricted areas of interest, and then the need for repetitive activities, so doing the same thing over and over and over. But if you go back to the idea of social communication, that really is how we want people to start to understand this, so that you can have a kid who just looks completely, you know, in the community we always say normal. Instead of normal, we say typical, because my, you know, typical is the politically correct thing, and I don't care if you use it or not. I think we need to let people be more comfortable from where they are to ask questions. But it's a social communication disability, and of course, the holidays are a time for sociability.
Yeah.
And we all have our hidden interior yearnings of
yes.
being together and having it be cozier or funnier or not eating too much, or you know, all of
we want the Norman Rockwell Courier and Ives experience,
right?
Yeah,
right. And this is if you could design a more torturing experience for many of our kids, you couldn't exceed the holiday experience.
Everyone lined up at a Thanksgiving table.
Well, one of the ways that our people cope is by strict warning ahead of time about change, but adherence to the regular routine.
Okay.
And so we've taken a child who is used to getting up, and maybe they have breakfast every way the same way, and then they go to school and they've got their routine, and Tuesday they get to go over to MSU sports skills, and then maybe on Saturday they get to go bowling, and the routine is part of how they get through their
yeah.
life. And the holidays, we've taken school out of the picture. We've added different personalities. Sometimes our families get wild and we stay up late. And then we want to sleep in the morning. That kind of thing is very, very difficult for people on the spectrum to cope with. So one of the traditional ways that we suggest families try and cope with this is by letting... Well, my personal bias on this is that I think we all need to be doing about half of what we plan to do. I like an advent-oriented observation before Christmas where we have more stillness. But that's my little nerd self, and certainly not what my kids have been terribly interested in, although they're adults now and they kind of get more what I'm talking about. But people do tend to overschedule themselves. They have over expectations. They have lots of focus on the material components of presents and wrapping and distraction. So you can take a pretty fatigued family just staying with coping with a child with a disability. And then we add, we pull the rug out from under the routine, and then we add additional
chaos
and heartfelt desire to have a good time. You know, you want your kids to have a great memory. It's just that if you got a child with autism, lots of times that really doesn't have currency with them. The it is so uncomfortable. So for your friend who posted the thing, what a wonderful thing. Lots of the kids, depending on the degree of involvement, I mean, one of the things I wanted to clarify too was the basic underpinnings of autism are the social communication disorder. Many of our kids, that means that they also have severe language disorders. Some kids with autism are very fluent about what they want to talk about. That's the little professor talk. Or they have, you know, PhDs in nuclear physics before they're four and things like that. But many of our children don't have language, or they have assistive devices so that they may have a pad, a tablet, or they may use pictures. So making space for that in a routine, if you're inviting a family with a child and they're going to give this a try, letting the child come over to visit the house beforehand to practice having a visit or practice what we're going to do. And that leads to something called social narrative, which is when maybe you'll take pictures and you'll make a picture book to show what the routine is. Many of the modifications that are recommended for individuals on the autism spectrum are very, very good for typical people as well.
Right. Not a bad idea, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Especially during the holidays.
Well, you know,
I agree, because I think people are so stressed to begin with that you're also dealing with people who, under normal circumstances for them, might be much more accommodating, but they're trying to juggle too much. They're trying to cook and shop and do all of these things so that they're snappish and they're not at their best.
Right.
Either.
And like, oh, this is like when my kids were little and I'd scream at them to get dressed so we could get to church on time. Wait a second, what's going on here? Whoops, I think I just put both feet in mouth. You know, really, it's the holiday. And many of the things our families who have kids with very challenging behaviors learn is that you have to set your priorities, and you don't get to have 17 priorities, as is a common illusion in our popular culture. Mm-hmm. Most of us in life really get to have about three things on the burner.
Do these youngsters also want some control over their diet? In other words, there's a lot of candy and, you know, all sorts of different kinds of foods at a lot of these holiday things. Would they like more predictability in the food that they're going to be served? Should you talk menu?
One of the things that I think is not well understood in the general population, it certainly has not been well understood in the medical world, and is just beginning to be researched in a meaningful way, are the degrees of sensory abnormalities that our kids have. This is, our children will see things differently visually. I have a son who would never look at what the central subject of a picture was, but would see the tiny little American flag way off in the corner that wasn't part of the theme of the photograph. Similarly, our kids may hear things more acutely. Lots of our kids are real hypersensitive to noise.
And light.
Light. There are several very articulate individuals on the spectrum who cannot tolerate, like, the light we have in here, the fluorescent. They'll get the jitter in it. You know, it's like they're picking up, you know, like, what is the dog ears have a bigger spectrum,
right?
You know,
sounds only dogs can hear. Yes.
They'll get through their lives by wearing a visor, mm-hmm. so that it blocks the light. Smells can be similarly hypersensitive. My son was with one of his beloved babysitters one time, and they went to visit a baby who had just soiled their diapers. He wouldn't go near a baby for 3 years because he didn't want to get that. So lots of kids have very idiosyncratic tastes. Diet can be a real challenge for our kids. And so the old polite expectation of take a bite, it's a new food, you have to take a bite, you don't have to like it, that's just a preposterous setup.
Yeah.
Like,
to fail.
Look at Aunt Jenny and give her a kiss. That, you know, don't set anybody up for that.
No.
But so the sensory range can be something that can be really disruptive, and that can precipitate anxiety, and then the anxiety can precipitate in the community, they're called meltdowns.
I was going to ask about that.
Mary, have you seen a better response over the last couple decades than would have been 1990?
I think there may be. increased appreciation that that clearly dreadful parent over in the corner of Myers who has a child who's just throwing a terrible tantrum, that in fact your parenting techniques may not be effective for that child because this child may be, you know, beyond your appreciation in terms of challenge. We've had, when my son was young, people, strangers would come up and say, there's nothing the matter with that boy that a good, you know, spanking wouldn't do. And we also had people who could understand what we were dealing with. We had one lady up north, and when we were doing our best to pretend like we had three arms each, and we were having managing a breakfast, and she just wrote this note, and she just came by and dropped the note off and smiled at us. And she said, I see tremendous love here. Oh. And that was like so validating for us. I think people are less judgmental. And then the other thing, I think if you're a family and you're beginning to catch on that you've got a kid who's going to be unpredictable and your life is not going to go in the direction, you're not going to have the kind of independence and spontaneity that you may have had when you were a young couple or like that, you learn that really your job is to do the best you can as a parent. You are going to have to do things for your child that other families aren't going to, and you just do that. And so when, you know, if you start to get kind of your balance on this and you begin to realize what's your business and what's not your business, it's easier to let that ridiculous grumpy person who needs to harumph or do some body language or even say something out in public, you're willing to let that energy be their business and not your family's business, that kind of
it's
protection.
It's harder, though, I suspect, when it's a member of your own family, you know, because there can be, you know, sometimes grandma and grandpa came out of the era where they didn't realize these things, and they require a certain amount of education. And I guess part of it, too, is this idea that somehow if the child has a meltdown, that that's a failure. And it's not a failure. It's just one of the things that happens.
Yes.
And you have to learn to cope with that. And I think that's part of, that's hard for a lot of people to understand.
And one of the sort of the tenets of the meltdown is if this is, if the child is not at risk of harming themselves or others, is that this is actually a behavior that's better left ignored.
Yes.
Because what happens when you have a tantrum is everybody gets up and runs around and the Groucho Marx show, the chicken comes down and you've won $100,000 and the security show up and maybe they'll even let you get through the checkout line faster. A lot of attention is paid to that, and that tends to be a reinforcing phenomenon.
You know, just listening to you today, we have someone in our family, extended family, that has autism, but we also have a couple people who have Alzheimer's, and there's a lot of similarity in learning what that's like. Especially at
dinners. We're having to adjust a lot.
Yeah, well, absolutely.
Yeah,
especially
but a family that gets to do that is really getting a gift. Because you're just suspending what the sometimes too rigid, you know, behavior rules can be.
You have to let it go.
And you get to learn what love is about.
Yeah. Yes.
And you get to learn what appreciation is about. And so it can kind of be like that crucible where you, well, I was going to use another slang term that I won't. But, you know, it helps you separate what you really want from what you really didn't care much about.
You know, I've heard it called the glorious burden. That may be a little bit too religious for me, but it's a glorious burden.
Yeah.
It's something that you accept. You get other people to accept it with you, too, though.
I think, for me, in some ways, you're absolutely right about that. We are a very controlling society, I know.
Yeah.
I mean, we really do want everything nailed down, and we want young people. We don't want young people acting up. We don't want them doing things in the reality.
And some of us
are
extremely like that, to the point of, you know, I just always said I got paid money to have obsessive compulsive disorder. Pretty good setup for a while. But, you know, when it comes to other people's business, parenting is a complicated one for a typical child about what's your business, what's their business, and where do you step in.
You still have to put in boundaries. You still have to do those kinds of things to try to help students and young people and their children cope with the world that they're going to inherit, but it's understanding and recognizing what matters and what doesn't matter. I want to thank Mary. May you tell me, just in closing, a little bit more about your organization and how people can get more information?
If they go to our website, Mid-Michigan Autism Association, our website is under a little bit of, it's not under construction, it's under renovating. It's getting renovated. They can sign up. We do have a monthly newsletter that tries to talk about activities for families raising kids with disabilities and commentary on, you know, state level policy programs and local. We really
and
are
I,
into local programs.
I hope that we'll get Mary Sharp back again. Thank you very much. This is LCC Radio, WLNZ, 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan. This is Bonnie and Bill signing off. See you next Monday night. Thank you.